Climate deal, schlimate deal. Am I right? We don't actually have to do anything, do we? Hey there, world citizens. Trace here for DNews. Thanks for tuning in. At the recent COP21 climate conference in Paris, 195 countries promised planet Earth we would stop messing with her. The press is calling it a huge win for environmentalists, world cooperation, and, of course, for the health of our planet. President Obama said in a speech after the deal was signed, this could be the best chance we have to save the one planet we have. But we just signed a piece of paper. We haven't actually done anything yet. The UN has held a climate change conference of the parties every year since the mid-90s, but more often the narrative is about their shortcomings rather than their successes. The US famously avoided the 1997 Kyoto Protocol, and at the 2009 Copenhagen conference, the rich European countries, who got rich by burning coal, told developing nations like China and India to agree to the same cuts that they were imposing on themselves. Nah, bro. There are a lot of examples of climate policy fails, but listing them all is gonna get depressing. While we fight over language, climate change is continuing to ravage our planet. Knowing this, decision makers came into the COP21 conference in Paris with a whole different strategy. Unlike conferences in the past, Paris's COP21 let each country set its own goals for limiting or slowing carbon emissions, for fighting deforestation, for maintaining transparency, and for identifying adverse effects in climate change. In the last year, every country submitted a set of goals called Intended Nationally Determined Contributions, INDCs. Though each are different, they are all based on keeping Earth under the dangerous 2°C temperature increase that they all agreed was the worst at Cancun's COP back in 2010. Now everyone has the same finish line, and they have their own map to get there, and they've all signed the COP21 deal. We're on our way, y'all, right? Maybe. So next, each country shifts their wooden-cogged bureaucracies into gear toward a net-zero emissions goal. From now until 2018, when they meet next, they're going to assess how to achieve the first steps laid out in the Paris Accords. Then, they'll showcase their kickstarted plans. According to their INDCs, China is going to be investing heavily in clean energy and will attempt to decrease their carbon emissions after 2030. The US will reduce carbon emissions by 26% from levels measured in 2005. The European Union will cut 40%, Brazil will cut 37%, and they're going to curb deforestation to keep the Amazon carbon sink intact, because trees suck up carbon. Yay! India, the third largest CO2 emitter, is planning to promote clean energy generation and, of course, consumption. And even many Pacific islands, some of which will be underwater before the 2100 final target date, are submitting INDCs. The Paris Agreement is exceedingly complex, but COP21 guarantees each nation has their own reachable goals. The politicians involved are calling this a huge diplomatic success, but is that the scientific reality? Vox put together a chart from Climate Action Tracker data and found without COP21's plan, we were on track to hit a 3.8°C increase in Earth temperature by 2100. With the Paris pledges, we're still going to hit 2.7°C. That is way over the 2°C upper limit. The agreements call for deep reductions, and we need these deep cuts, and they are going to hurt. So, to help developed nations overachieve their goals, rich countries pledged $100 billion per year in public and private investment by 2020 to help poorer countries get affordable clean energy and lessen their struggles to meet these ambitious climate goals. Look, in the end, the Paris talks are revolutionary on one hand, because nearly 200 countries have recognized publicly that lowering carbon emissions to curb climate change is important. But what happens now? The diplomats have to convince their governing bodies of their home nations to follow this pledge. What we have to do now is, as citizens, keep the pressure on our leaders. Keep this in the news. While failing to meet the actual goals aren't punishable, these leaders will have to show up in public transparently and say why they didn't meet those goals every 5 years. In the end, most are seeing this as the first step of a long, hard road, but a road that will have our children and descendants breathing easier. Of course, some countries won't be breathing at all because climate change will have already drowned some of them, overrunning their land with ocean. If you want to know more about those places, check out that video here.
At minimum, even with extremely rigorous cuts to global emissions and oceans that are far less sensitive to climate change than we'd expect, 1.9% of the population of coastal countries would still be affected by flooding.
What do you guys think about the Paris talks and these conferences in general? Why don't you let us know down in the comments? And make sure you keep coming back here every day for more DNews. We'll be right back.